RMLD Board of Commissioners recognizes the importance of hearing public comment on items on the agenda as well as items not on the official agenda. This comment is being directed to the chair, and please state your name and address before doing so. I don't think we have any members of the public here, but just for the record.
You have one member.
Oh, we do. Sorry, sir. Thank you, James.
Scott.
Did you say Scott?
Yeah.
Correct.
Scott James.
I apologize. we'll have public comment in just a second if you have something to say. Dave will be the board secretary. Is that okay?
I accept.
Okay. We have George from the town of Wilmington. Hello, George.
Hello.
We do not have any. The FinCom liaisons aren't here today. And with that, we will go to public comment. And before I do that, just a couple of quick remarks. That next week, next Wednesday, there's a meeting at the library on the 23rd to discuss redevelopment concepts for this general area of town, including the industrial area and the RMLD site. I just encourage everybody to look that up and attend so that we can all participate in discussions about the future of the area.
Where is it, Dave? Excuse me,
the library? At the library, I believe it's 6:30 on the 23rd.
6:30.
I'm just going to confirm that. If it's wrong, I will correct it later, but I believe it's at 6:30. Okay. And the other one is that, as you know, we have a great process here at RLD, which is unusual for public agencies, where we commissioners actually go in and take a look at accounts payable every Saturday or payroll, and we actually have this step that's kind of an exceptional one. And we'll be, you know, improving that even further in the coming months, and Colleen can address that during her report briefly, but just to update everybody on that. And with that, public comment. Scott, did you want to just, no? Oh, we were really hoping you would, because nobody.
Well, sure, it's been a busy 24 hours.
Yeah. Well, I know, but.
Not necessarily the folks in this room.
Oh, wait, it's true.
Excuse me, commission.
I know they have here too. Everybody's been straight out, and everybody did a great job during the storm. So thank you, by the way, to everybody at RMLD for that.
Yes.
And so, any other public comment, George? Or there's no liaisons here.
Next week, 23rd, we do our CAB budget. Start our budget review process.
Yep.
We'll be in Wilmington.
Okay. Great. Okay. And then we're going to.
Where are you going to be?
At the high school.
At the high school?
Okay. And we'll take up the budget at our November meeting.
Mr. Chair?
Tom?
I know you mentioned it, but I just want to add on to, I think days like today when we have massive power outages in the state, it really does reflect well on RMLD. I think people realize just how responsive the folks are. You can't prevent the weather from coming through the town, but when it comes through, it's really how you respond. Very well managed.
Great.
Yep. Thank you.
Polls down?
Yeah.
There was a poll down by REI, right?
Yes.
Was that the only one, or were there others?
Mr. Chairman, may I make a comment?
Please.
John.
Nice to meet you.
We stole him, highly qualified. And we hired him as a general foreman. He's both an engineer, a master electrician, and a lineman, so well qualified. And he just got promoted to assistant director. And he's been an asset hitting the ground. So he's helped out a lot since he's been here, which is great.
John.
Welcome aboard.
A year? 2 years.
Great. Wow. Yeah, welcome aboard.
Thank you. And yeah, just to confirm what I said before, that meeting is at 6:30. I just checked.
Thanks okay.
At the library. It's an economic development forum.
6:30 p.m.
No, it's in the morning. Oh, yes, it is at 6:30 a.m. It would be fun to prank and have everybody show up and expect it to be open at 6:30 a.m. But 6:30 to 9 p.m. Wednesday night. Come one, come all, and discuss the future of the industrial area and the rest of the town. So with that, I think we are ready to move to Colleen's report, the general manager.
Thank you,
report.
And good evening. So I have five tonight, so this is great. All right, so the first, number A is the payment to the town of Reading report and meetings schedule. So just a little background to bring everybody up to speed. I did a study back in May of 2018. It was voted that we were going to freeze the payment at $2.4 million for 2019, 20, and 21. Because my projections showed a convergence with the reduction of kilowatt-hour sales with the payment to the town escalating at a CPI. For a long-term financial due diligence, we decided to take a little stop and look at it. I did my study, made some recommendations to go towards a standardized calculation that's used typically for the health of a utility, which is usually based on the percentage of kilowatt-hour sales. Above the line, we need to use another calculation, which is a percentage of net plant. We're adding a lot of plant lately. So the true indicative for me is the kilowatt-hour sales. The board asked if we could do an update to that study. So energy, we asked a couple of different folks. You really need to have a specialty in utilities and be able to survey all the municipals, be able to talk that language and understand payments to towns. So we are targeting a December 5th date for the presentation by John Zemarangis of Energy New England. We
In this meeting?
In this meeting. Well, it would be a separate meeting for that.
Okay.
We took the time because, although we had said, you know, it's a two-year freeze, and it wasn't going to take 2 years to do the study, but we wanted to do a good job. Because we transitioned from a fiscal year to a calendar year, it was very important for us and Wendy to finish all of the financial projections for the new calendar year and have Chuck do all of his projections for power supply, kilowatt-hour sale projections. And we just finished that budget, sent it to you guys a couple weeks ago. So all of those financials got sent down to E&E. So they're putting all of that in their model. So we probably could have had it a little bit sooner, but we have budget next month, the CAB, as you said, on the 23rd, and then the board is, what's the date? I'm sorry? No, I know. What's the date of the board for the budget? November 21st is the board meeting. So it'll be pretty much the first week of December.
Yep.
And so
December 5th.
December Thursday night, December 5th. So if that pleases the board, then John's available, that's when we're going to be presenting. I'm supposed to go down. I don't have a draft or anything yet. I'm supposed to go down a week from Friday to be able to go over the parameters that were input and get a copy of the draft. And when I get back, I'll be able to provide that to a copy to the board.
That's wonderful.
Questions on that?
I just was, so I assume, I haven't seen the town meeting dates yet, but I assume, is that an agenda item for town meetings or in someone?
Well, I don't know if it'll come up, but I know the town meeting's on the 12th of November and then the 14th, and then potentially on the 21st. So, I mean, there's always a lot going on in November. We have our budget, we have our meeting, so I think it's great timing, what you're describing, and that we can really, you know, dig into this beginning in December, and we can share with the community as soon as we get it, and have those conversations and reviews with our counterparts in the town and on the CAB, and, you know, that'll take a good couple, 3 months early to do that.
Okay.
And I think we're kind of ahead of where we hoped we would be, that we can have those conversations into the winter and hopefully get this wrapped up, because there's a lot of things we want to do. The towns have tons of things to do, substantive projects. You have lots of substantive projects, and getting this formula figured out and in place, will help us move on. And,
Well, there was a little bit of delay with transitioning, but the benefits of going from the fiscal to calendar year, there's so many that it was worth the wait in order for them to have a more accurate analysis.
John?
If I may, I'd just like to also reiterate that we're not alone in this with this issue. The Wall Street Journal about a week and a half ago had an article that electricity use kilowatt hours are down nationwide from somewhere between 7 to 9%, at least from their analysis. Most So we're not the only ones facing this issue, is my point.
Right.
So it's one that we need to address.
I'd actually...
Mr. Chair?
Yeah, please.
The uniqueness, though, of New England versus the rest of the country, and yes, kilowatt-hour sales are down across the nation, but New England is very special because our costs are like no other in the rest of the nation. So when their kilowatt-hour sales go down, it's a little bit easier of a margin for them to digest that. Whereas in New England, especially during the winter, and our price spikes and volatility with our grid is unique. And anytime you go to a presentation, they say, and here's what's going on in the world, and then you have New England. So that's how it's described. And I think I went through that before. And, you know, when we get through this payment thing and everything, maybe next year I could have Mike Zinka come back. He just did a presentation for staff on power supply and stuff. We'll have him come back. He does a great thing within an hour, and it will be if we can make it a little workshop and stuff so that more people can learn about the world of wholesale power.
That's wonderful. Yeah, and then the parallel discussion that we can all have is electrification, sustainability, and our towns that we serve, to the extent we can electrify things, and we have load growth, it benefits RMLD, it benefits the town. We have existing programs to help our towns do this. So one hope would be that we can enhance that. At some point, maybe I don't want to put George on the spot, but I know the town of Wilmington has done quite a bit in these areas. You've done some good programs with your buildings and electrification, and so it's maybe at some point at a meeting, if you want to talk a little bit about how the town has availed itself of RMLD programs, but I didn't prepare you for that question. But
No, I'll talk. I mean, it happens to be my specialty.
Yeah, if you have a minute now, I mean, as long as we're talking about it.
Yeah, well, we only have, as far as our town schools go, we have one that we have to complete, and then that will be 100%.
So what are you referring to there?
As far as converting over from incandescents
to lighting,
fluorescents to LED.
Okay.
We're still working on some of the projects going on, VFDs, on some of the motors and that, but our town library, we're just wrapping one up a project. So we take advantage of as much of the rebates
sure.
and improvements we can do. We work with Tom and
here at RMLD.
Yep.
So just give us 30 more seconds on that. There's the lighting retrofits, then you mentioned another one, and what was that again?
VFDs, variable frequency drives,
yep.
that go on the pumps and motors
yep.
that we have. We're just completing our library. We just converted over our heating system. So part of our CIP, our capital improvements. That's some of the things that we move forward with. So,
so
5-year plan, very typical to you guys, and that's what we.
Well, I've heard a little bit about this. I think the activities the town of Wilmington are doing are very helpful to the other towns too. I think you've kind of maybe led the way. I may be wrong about that, but the more we can learn and share with the other towns, the better.
Sure.
Anyway, thank you for the update, Colleen.
Sure.
Did I get that right?
No, I didn't finish. I'm only on B. But
go ahead.
Okay. So B I already did. That was just the schedule.
Yep.
So as far as C is concerned, the Wilmington substation update. So as I mentioned last time, I've been here since 2013. So right away we did an assessment and found that substation was, pretty much at the end of its useful life and not able to be continued to be repaired. When things are broken, there's just so many times you can put tape on it and you just can't make it happen anymore. So we started actually looking for the land as soon as we were done with the assessment, and it's been a very difficult process because you don't necessarily have a substation in the town that feeds that substation, but we're serving everything. So for example, North Reading substation feeds analog. So you're trying to place these things so that they're balanced and you're able to provide the best contingencies of backup feeding. So you want to locate this in the growth area, which is Ballardville. The existing substation in Wildwood, it's in an environmentally sensitive area, meaning wetlands. It's not big enough, as Hamid puts it, to do a surgical bypass and build one parallel. So we've been looking for a while, and we've gone with different people. And as you know, easements that were too expensive, way too expensive to make it feasible. And we landed on that piece of land on Mass 125, which was perfect. Right underneath the 115 lines, we've been working with National Grid, negotiating back and forth for another couple of years. you know, all the while keeping our fingers crossed. And then just before we signed the purchase and sale, the title search came back and said they didn't own the land. It's actually owned by the town of Wilmington. So we met with George, and we've had conversations with the town manager. And then on Monday night, we met with the Wilmington Select Board. Hamid and I went. We had slides. We showed them where on the land we would place it. We could tuck right up underneath the 115 lines. We also showed we could be a little bit farther away. It would cost us a little bit more money for easements, but I tried to show the flexibility. The land, I mean, the town is happy to found, as one of the select board put it, $20 in a pocket that they didn't know they had. But at the same time, I tried to really put across the urgency of this. The land, without the assessor's line that was incorrectly drawn, is a total of 19 acres. We were looking for three. We can live with 1.5 as just a substation. We wanted three so we could build a microgrid, right? Because we'd want to have that battery eventually and the resiliency for the town. We can live with 1.5. We want three. The entire lot of land is Article 97, which is the Bromfield protection, basically Wetlands Protection Act. So there's some restrictions that apply to that, replication that would have to occur. And so tomorrow happens to be a different, so we left the meeting with that I was going to dig into the Article 97 restrictions. The town is still considering what they would like to do with the land, keeping us in mind, but I did say, listen, this is of an urgent nature. We really need to know if you want to work with us, because otherwise we need to move on. Not that there's a lot of land that meets the criteria that we need. We're really running out of that, so we hope that this works. But I was tasked with the action item of going off and looking into Article 7. And lo and behold, tomorrow Senator Tarr is coming, so I wrote him a letter today and asked him, when we were done with all of the other topics that we're discussing with him tomorrow, if he could help me and give me some direction as far as if there's any possibility of an Article 97 restriction for public hardship, because this is, you know, electricity is not out there with food and water, and you know, maybe help us with discussions with the town, but without stepping on the town's toes. It is their land, but I was tasked with looking into that, so I'd like to be able to go back to the selectmen or their town meeting and say, this is what I found out. And that's kind of where we left it. So I guess I'll find out a little bit more tomorrow. I'm more than happy to send you a copy of what I sent to Senator Tarr. Tracy sent it out for me today to our lobbyist. And then you can read where we are on it. But it's kind of what I just said to you. Just ask him if he could give us a little bit of guidance is what I asked for. It's still in the budget for 21-22, right? I mean?
Yes.
And we told them, I said, we've been doing this for 3-4 years, and it's going to take a couple of years to build it, so it's really important. Yeah.
Is purchasing the land the only option, or is another way to do it?
No, they mentioned a lease, which, you know, we're willing to discuss anything. I mean, obviously, we have to be careful of public money with leasing. We would want to lock it in. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure that I really drove it home that when you build a substation, it's $11 million, and you really should probably try to go for a 99-year lease if we would go in that direction. It's not something that, just because it gets towards the end of its useful life in about 40 or 50 years, that you just want to pick up and move. We're assuming that the load growth in Wilmington will stay in the Ballardville area, and that's a good location, as I said at the beginning, for balancing the load. Do you want to... Mr. Chairman, can I ask Hamid to add anything? Is there anything else to add?
No, just the fact that, you know, from the time that we...
Do you want to take the mic so people can hear you? Yeah. You are for us, but...
You have to be on TV.
There's a lot of people out there.
Sure, they want to see you, Hamid.
Good evening. I'm Hamid Jafari, Director of Engineering and Operations. And we stress the fact that from the day that, you know, basically you agree to do the transaction, whether leasing or purchasing, it's going to take approximately 3 years for that substation to go online. And we are on borrowed time, basically, with the Station 5. So I think Colin did a wonderful presentation and really stressed the fact that it's very important to have the substation. in that particular area, because that's where the load center is. There was another idea brought up about analog and building substation with analog, and that's really too far away from Ballardvale. So even if you get the substation built right over there, you're going to have some problems, voltage problems, right by the time we get to the Andover line, which is Ballardvale is located. So I think we pretty much laid out the whole picture, you know, for everything that they needed to know in order to make the decision. We are hoping that, you know, they make a favorable decision to sell us the land. Selling would be better than leasing, what Colin said. Because substations, once you build them, $11 million. Now, it's not something that 30 years later I could say, okay, I can lift this equipment and put it someplace else. Well, 30 years from now, we're going to be in a worse situation because there's no land to build or nowhere to go, really. So it should be 99 years lease if that's going to go that direction. So purchasing would be the best option. And if leasing, you're talking about 99 years old, but by then, would be beyond my lifetime. So.
Yeah, but Phil will still be here. So.
Yes.
Yeah, I got a question. If tomorrow the present Wilmington substation goes down, what area is going to be affected? How much area?
It's going to be the Woburn area, Woburn Street area. You're talking about the Route 125 area. You know, that definitely industrial Ave, it's going to get affected. So, you see, we got three substations, and all three substations, they're connected, they're like a network. They're not closed in, but, you know, we relay the load from one substation to another.
Point of the question is that those businesses and those locations,
oh, yeah, they're going to get.
They're under threat right now.
Oh, definitely.
They're under threat right
yes.
now at this point.
Yeah.
I hope somebody realizes that out there,
right.
that these businesses are under threat if
yeah.
this gets delayed. And it doesn't happen.
Definitely. It's not going to be good for the businesses. Especially the growth in Ballardvale area, you know, Route 125 sector.
Yeah.
Those are the ones that they're going to be suffering the most.
Yeah, I share Phil's sentiment on that.
Right.
And also certainly for Analog, who is our largest
yes.
customer and has contributed a huge amount to our base,
right.
basically. And, of course, they contribute a huge amount to the overall area in terms of integrated circuit manufacture and being leading manufacturers of these devices
right.
in the world. And so the more we can make this reliable power
yeah.
for Analog, I think it helps everybody,
mm-hmm.
Certainly including the town of Wilmington,
right.
Which I'm sure has a good tax
right.
base there as well.
Right. But the thing is, too, I think the department will continue to try to do the best in terms of maintaining the property,
yes.
maintaining that substation. I don't want to give the impression we're going to die tomorrow. You know.
No, actually what we did 2 years ago, we rejuvenated, not 100%, but to the best that it could be,
right.
the switchgear.
Right.
The transformers are old, but, you know, definitely they show some signs of deteriorations. If those transformers, they go tomorrow, I'm not saying they're going to go tomorrow, but, you know, you never know with the old substations.
Sure.
So if they go, we're not going to be able to find, you know, a mobile substation, because most mobile substations, they're configured in the delta Y configuration. These transformers are YY type or star type that nobody makes them,
right.
not even at this voltage, 34.5 kV.
Right.
So it would be very, very difficult. So the only option would be to transfer the load to station 4 and station 3. That means, like what John mentioned, that's compromising now the analog. And I don't think we want to compromise our biggest load in the entire service territory. So the reliability is important. Yes, sir.
So two things. One, I'm wondering if, because we all recognize the importance and seriousness, would it make sense, or has it already been done, to memorialize the issue in writing? I mean, it's one thing to present, and that's important. The presentations go in the files or, you know, stay in the laptop. So, you know, and I don't mean this in a threatening way, but just
yes.
a way to heighten the sense of urgency.
Right.
Because I think when people get that in writing, they respond more seriously. It's just that they have a lot of things coming at them. A lot of stuff gets presented at meetings. So, you know, when you laid out and Colleen this 3-year window, I think having that in a well-written document would serve a lot of purposes
yeah.
in terms of talking about it in various forums and also in adding it. And I guess the last comment is, George, whether you would have a lot of it's dealing with town meeting, and is there anything else you
would... As Colleen, the general manager, had said, we've discussed the situation.
Yeah.
I think everybody's fully aware of the impact.
Yeah.
I mean, barring a catastrophic failure, the severity, everybody is fully aware of where we're at right now. So,
do you think there's a sentiment towards supporting a...
Well, I won't speak for my colleagues and the people in the Board of Selectmen. I'm sure they're going to come up with it. So, but I think they fully understand and any repercussions. But I think people are willing to work with the RMLD to get this finalized.
Good.
Get this
together. That's good. That's good.
Okay.
Good. Thank you.
Thanks, Hamid.
Thank you.
Can I make another call?
Please.
Just so we're clear, though, even if the town says okay and we go to the town meeting in May, I still have to address the Article 97, which is a Wetlands Act on the use of the land. So that's why I wrote the letter to Senator Tarr for guidance.
Sure.
And
which goes to your legislation.
Maybe,
so.
Yeah, and maybe call the governor who gave me the grant for the battery up on the phone and ask him for a little help, too. So it's got to take its steps, but I relayed the urgency, so I'm hoping to give you an update soon. Okay? Any questions on that? All right, so we're on upcoming FinCom meeting. So I was asked to be part of the FinCom forum on November 6th. I haven't really gotten much details from the town.
It's the 4th, actually.
6th?
It is the 6th.
It is the 6th. I haven't really gotten much update, like an agenda or what the questions would be. I've asked Wendy to attend with me, and I'm, you know, in the absence of questions, I'm going to be presenting similar to what I did with the select board, which is basically, you know, everything that the RMLD has to offer for all of our programs and how we can work with the town as we do with Wilmington. To help out financially with our rebates and other programs that we offer. But I guess I'm assuming there may be some more questions that they'll have some time to put together some answers to. But that's my goal right now is to do a similar presentation that I just did for the selectmen last month.
Yeah, Karen is on FinCom. She just raised her hand. Do you want to just briefly address? Yeah, please.
Come on up
to the mic, Karen. Karen Herrick is on FinCom, and she got here a little bit after the meeting started. But thanks for coming, Karen.
Thank you. We are really excited, thank you, Mr. Chair, to have Wendy and Colleen come and visit us. And we did just meet last night, and we're in the process of gathering some questions, which Eric has asked us to have them to him by the 25th so we can give you time. So, we're very much looking forward to hearing about, you know, what we can work on together.
Wonderful.
I was hoping that we would get whatever you wanted so that Wendy and I would have some time to do the analysis and make sure that whatever we're giving you is tight so that, you know, that it's useful.
Oh, I had one question. One of the FinCom members was asking about minutes online so they could, catch up. And I'm not sure if the minutes past March have been posted online. I haven't verified this. That's what they said when they were looking last night. Is I think your annual reports and half year reports are up there and stuff too. So. Okay,
yeah,
thank you.
We'll focus on that. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for that reminder, Karen.
All right, we'll get you questions.
Okay.
All right, thank you, Karen.
Are we gonna? Where are we on the on that question and approval of minutes? Where are we caught up to at this point? Maybe later in the meeting, just update us on where we are in terms of, you don't have to do it right now, but are we caught up on approving minutes so that they're ready to be posted? So that's all. But just maybe later in the meeting, just update us.
Right.
Thanks, Tracy.
And then the last and the best is my evaluation. Which was due in July. So I just actually finished Hamid and Wendy's groups. We go through all of the IBEW and all the senior managers, and then we roll that up into all of the accomplishments. And usually we have a subcommittee, which I think is John and
Tom
and Dave.
Yeah.
They come on it too, yeah.
Yeah. And so I guess I'm requesting to have a meeting tucked in there. I don't think it took that long. You guys were just dazzled, and it was fairly quick last year.
Very dazzled.
So if I could have a meeting, that would be awesome.
Yep. So I think one of the things that's very helpful, and I think you mentioned it, so if we could get the self-assessment that you should provide, that's very helpful, I think, for the commissioners. And then the rest of the stuff, we can the staff that
right.
you, with your...
But can we set a meeting date,
yes,
though?
Yes, let's try to do that.
Yeah,
that's
okay.
Oh, okay, well, I was... You want to do it when we talk about schedules?
Yeah, at the yeah,
okay.
We'll schedule,
that's fine.
Scheduling at the end of the meeting.
Okay, well, that's all I had, then.
I got one question.
Oh.
Phil?
Where are we on the 20-year agreement?
I gave you an update last time. So Kathleen Ryback, everything's ready to go, and then there's so many days before next May when it expires.
Mm-hmm.
She has like 180 days before the expiration that she has to send everything out, so it's all timed and ready to go.
Okay.
And then each town, and each town had done it differently in the past, takes certain votes in order to continue the 10 years, right? Because it's a rolling 10 years to make 20 years. So some of the towns, and I can't remember off the top of my head, but some of them was a town meeting and some of them was a selectman vote. And that's all timed in there. They have a certain amount of time to get that back, and then it gets signed, and then we just keep going.
Yeah.
So can I get from Kathleen what we said at the last meeting, and I'll email it to you? Would
yeah,
that be
fine.
Okay?
That's fine.
Or I'll email it to everyone as information?
I think all the votes actually were taken by the select boards themselves. I don't remember actually in the last go-around going back to a town meeting. I don't remember that quite truthfully. But that's, you know, send me what you got, and we'll, you know.
To verify how they actually did it, I'll have to ask Kathleen, but in the 20-year agreement, it says that it can be done in different ways, I'm pretty sure. So
okay.
Let me verify that.
He says Wilmington is
a
town meeting.
Wilmington was a town meeting?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Because I do remember meeting with the board, with the select board up there at one point, too. So. Okay.
So I can't remember calling in. You may remember. I just don't remember. But do we know if commissioners have the 20-year report, and if not, should we review that as part of governance? Or
it gets sent out for everybody to review again.
Right.
Nothing's changed,
right.
But you vote to continue as a section.
Right. Yeah. So, but part of what your question is, I assume, is
yeah. I mean, there has to be some sort of vote because
yeah, we
want
to
see
it before you vote on it.
Basically, the vote is if you don't want to stay in, then the vote goes over the next 10 years to wind everything up on both sides.
So maybe just a suggestion, I think the action item might be we should have a timeline so there's a point when it has to be officially renewed, and then there's working backwards,
yeah.
So you want to make sure everybody has a chance to look at it.
That probably exists.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. We have an official timeline.
Right.
I thought I had presented it at last meeting, but I'm glad to do it again. But let me send it out in an email. Kathleen's got it all right down to the day of...
Okay.
of everything that needs to be sent out, when it needs to come back, in a nice letter that gets sent to everyone.
Okay.
I think she was waiting until the end of the year to send
sure,
it out.
Sure. Okay. That's fine. We're good.
I remember you gave us an update last time.
But I can't remember. It's not age, Dave. It's just, I got a lot.
I remember talking about it.
Okay. I guess I'm getting old, I guess.
Ready for
Chuck?
Chuck.
Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck.
Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck. Chuck
before I step into power supply this evening, I just wanted to take a quick moment and thank Hamid and his team for the work that they've done today to get the system back up to its optimal performance. I very much appreciate it because I went out and secured an awful lot of kilowatt hours in power supply that I was kind of hoping could be delivered advantageously to RMLD ratepayers, and Mother Nature interrupted that process, and Hamid's team is going up against it to restore that. And as you walked in this evening, you may have noticed that our customer service department stayed to man the phone system and take calls from ratepayers trying to ascertain what's going on. Pun intended, people feel rather powerless when the electricity goes out, and looking for information is the one way that they can get a modicum of control over the situation. So we man the phones, we relieve Hamid's team to go out and do what they need to do, and I just wanted to call attention to the role the customer service is playing out there right now.
So, yeah.
Without further ado, we'll launch into the August report, and I'm just going to record one of these, and you can play it over for the entire season. But basically, our actuals are tracking with the budget right now. So we're in very good shape. We're not expecting much in the way of changes. There's a little that goes up here, a little that goes down here once in a while, but for the most part, the market is stable, and the costs are what we expected. We did have in next year's budget that had gone out, and subsequent to that, we signed a contract for some purchases under the TFA, and that's resulting in an estimated $1.3 million reduction already in the budget that was sent out. That will be rolled in because power supply is a pass-through, so it won't have any effect on the components of the budget that the CAB and the commissioners are reviewing, but just stuff that's going on. And yes, I'm tuning my department's horn. So, next slide, please. So we can see energy costs, which are the bulk, probably about 75% of the budget, are tracking very closely. That means that gas prices are very stable. Right now, we're not expecting big changes in those, although that savings that I mentioned a moment ago is because there was a slight uptick in the pricing to what was expected. We managed to lock in before the uptick, and so we're carrying a benefit forward because we locked in below that price uptick. Next, please. Capacity costs, we always expect to track very well. We set the capacity rate in the previous summer, so we know what it's going to be. We set the amount that we're going to be billed each month in the previous summer, so except for market shifts and abnormalities in how much gets collected, we don't see any variation or volatility in that component. Next, please. Transmission can bounce around a little bit. It's very weather dependent, but it's also a smaller component. And so what you saw in the energy is sort of mirrored on the other side of transmission, and our prices stay relatively stable and target towards budget. We are now, this is the August report, so we are through the bulk of our summer season, and the air conditioning load that is the most volatile driver on the system. Not necessarily the largest load, but certainly the most volatile driver on the system. So, you can see August, we're back to having the market component be added to the curve, i.e. our load is high enough that we actually purchase from the market. So we're happy that the load was back up again to where we would like it to be. You can see that the budgeted kilowatt hours, which are the black line, May and June were significantly low. July and August made some of that up. And we're just tracking a percent or two below what was budgeted for the year. So we're back in pretty good shape. And again, a lot of it is just weather-dependent information. That's you know, John, you were talking at the beginning about, you know, what some of the drivers were. And one of the biggest ones is weather. So next, please. That's it. We looked, Colleen's just asked me if I have a couple of slides. We had presented some slides, I believe, last month, and we updated them a little bit. Colleen also asked me to find out what was going on with the price of renewable energy certificates, and we looked at whether we could get an answer that would be reasonable in an hour this evening, but I'm not sure exactly which of our contracts will produce mass qualifying RECs and what the price on the qualifying RECs is going to be, whether we're seeing a stable uptick in price or a blip. So I would prefer not to get into a discussion on the RECs. There was a call, and I'm not sure how many of the commissioners received it. Somebody was looking for information on our solar expenditures, how much of the $250,000 matching grant with DOER we had used. I got the request last Friday. I was a little slow in getting back, so I know that some of you were contacted asking for the information. And I can give you a brief update on that this evening. We committed to match a $250,000 DOER incentive for solar development. To date, we have just about $30,000 that is actually in committed projects. So those are a known expenditure. We have several more applications that get close to about $20,000, but we don't know until they go through the process whether they're going to stay at that level and whether they're all going to be approved, whether they meet the qualifying thresholds. So the way that I answer the question is, out of the 250, $30,000 is expended, and we probably have just north of $200,000 that is uncommitted at this point for projects that may come in before the end of the project, the budget year, I guess, is the way to look at it for that.
Is this slower than you expected?
I honestly don't know how to answer the question. I didn't have an expectation as to what the rate would be on that and whether people tend to develop solar as a springtime project, which means we'll get hammered next spring, so that people have these systems in place to be able to take advantage of essentially the summer sun. I'm not sure how many are fall kinds of installations. I would expect winter to fall off because I don't expect people to be up putting holes in roofs through snow. It's not an advantageous time to be doing construction work in New England. So.
Is there a sunset on, like, is there a sunset beyond which if the funds aren't used, they use it or lose it sort of thing from the state side, or is it, where does it just go until it's gone?
It was originally set as a one-year program.
Okay.
So the answer to that would be at the end of a year, whatever isn't expended would revert back
to the state.
The state treasury. It's been allocated to DOER.
Okay.
And then those funds for us would become unencumbered.
Okay, so folks, if you're listening, put some solar on your roofs, use it or lose it. Thank you.
Well, what gets used or lost is the DOER money.
Use or lose the DOER money.
The money from us was diverted from our solar program to this.
Yeah.
And so if we don't spend it on this aspect,
we'll spend it on something else.
It will revert back to the solar program. Right. So it's not misplaced.
I just want to, can I add something?
Please.
I just want to add, though, that when we revert back to the RMLD rebate, this is a much better incentive program. And so maybe we can talk to Joyce and do another press release on it. But when we revert back to our rebate program, it's not as good.
Right.
So
I know we're deep in the middle of the meeting here and nobody's listening, but it is a very generous program. They give this between the state piece and the RMLD piece, I think it's $1.20 per what installed watt, right? Is that what it is? So, you know, you get several thousand dollars from RMLD in the state, plus you get a federal tax credit, which is also quite large, 30%, and there's a state piece of $1,000, I think a flat $1,000. So you really get, like, right now in this little window, you get a huge kind of chunk back towards your installation. It's sort of a window right now that we're in that may not return. You know, we hope it will, but the window is wide open at the moment. Okay, do you have a question? Here you are. I'll just repeat the question. Yeah. Oh. Sure. Just so you can ask your question. Yeah.
I've had my rabies shot.
Yeah. No worries. So I just gave him the word, so I'm probably stinking. So.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chair. I was gonna say I was super excited about the rebate. I think it's a great program, and really, like, I think through the end of the year, it's 30%. Unless hopefully the federal government will renew it, it might drop to 25%.
It will drop to 26% next year. Yeah.
26. Okay. So. So the downside, three downsides. One, he's like, you're going to have to cut some trees down, so that's going to take me a while to do. I'm in the process, and that's expensive, so it adds to the cost of the project.
Yes.
For 7.5 watts and all the rebates, it came out to be about $12,000, so it's a significant investment. And the downside about that was because the net metering policy as it's currently working means that I will never and we have great low rates, so I will never recoup the cost on the solar panels till around year 20. So that was kind of a whole. So we haven't said, I have the three guys lined up. We haven't said we're not going to do it, but it sort of changes the picture.
Sure.
You know?
Okay.
So I just want to share that.
Thanks. So thank you for that.
This is great.
Yeah. Just on that, I think the carbon benefit of cutting down trees in order to install solar is questionable. You know, I think it's probably better to have those trees stem. I don't know what's going on at your house, but white pines, they can fall anyway. White pines, they're different. Hummy hates white pines and Norway maples. John is nodding knowingly. Yeah, they're the ones that take down the lines.
Chuck, just for Karen's benefit and to reiterate what we said at the solar workshop, can you just in a couple of sentences describe again exactly why we're really not able to have a true net metering policy.
But also, are you guys revising and coming up with a new? You're not coming up with a new solar.
Not. We're looking at solar gardens and we're coming up with other programs. But we're talking about what transacts through the meter if you're producing it. And just in a couple of sentences, Chuck, if you
could. Please explain what the rate is. What happens if you have a solar on your roof? What's happening during 2 o'clock on a sunny day when you're at work?
What happens, and we did put a great deal of this information together. It still exists in slide format, and we're glad to share that information to people who would still find it relevant. But what happens at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, the solar system is producing at maximum, and customers are unable to use the total benefit of the solar system. In fact, over the course of the year, customers use about 35 to 40% of what a solar system produces directly.
Right.
And in order for them to benefit from that, they either need a storage device that will shift what the system produces to when they need to use it,
yeah.
Or they need some sort of a transactional mechanism that will push the power out onto the grid for others to use, and then at times when they need it, will provide it back. That's us.
Correct.
And we need to recover a facilities charge to be able to do that. So we have been looking at alternative pricing strategies that I think more clearly define that pricing requirement or pricing mechanism. We're also looking at other approaches to overcome that initial first cost, which is rather significant, and see if we can find ways to spread that out over time to the ratepayers, so that more of them can get over that front end hurdle, if you will.
So what are you paying per kilowatt hour right now to the customer for the electricity that's going back to the grid?
We pay them about 4.5 cents, which is the energy value on that. We
get 4.5 cents. So okay, that's the answer.
Yeah, so we're reimbursing them for the energy that they're producing.
Yep.
But we still have to collect for the distribution. And
of course. Yeah. So it's not nothing, it's not a lot, but it's half of what the, it's less than half of what the, you know, what they pay. Yeah. And it's different in other towns, and maybe we'll get a comparison someday. In other MLPs handle it differently.
We had pulled that together. I thought it had been distributed, but
we don't need to go sideline it into it today again. But thank you. Yeah, you did do that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Can I add one more thing? So I'm asking Chuck that if, you know, when we're done with everything that we got to do, that possibly in December, that his presentation would look at, you would see a chart, and on that chart, it's going to show you what the RPS is for the renewable portfolio standards, what the CES is, which is essentially what the Golden Bill is, plus we would get credit for non-carbon nuclear, and show you exactly where we are relative to those things, and everything that's open, so that you can see how we're going to continue to meet those goals, and it'll be on one slide. It'll be amazing, very informative. So if you want to do that in December,
sure.
Because as these projects come up, because we're signing up for the biomass project, you'll be able to see how those blocks of energy, when we purchase them, fit right into that renewable goal that we're trying to meet, the CES or the Golden Bill, which is more strict than the RPS for the IOUs. So, Chuck, can you do that for December?
Yes.
Please? Okay. Would that be all right? Can you add that to the agenda for December, Trace? Thanks.
All set?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Chuck.
Thank you, Chuck.
Wendy. Thanks.
Wendy Markowitz, Director of Business Finance and Technology. I sent out the August financials, the 8 months ending August 31st. I do not do a particular financial presentation on that, but I'll just do a little tidbits. We are under 1% on base revenue, but we're also 15% under on the operating and maintenance expenses as compared to budget. And we are down 2.3% kilowatt hour sales as compared to the first 8 months of 2018. Mm-hmm. Hopefully it's going to come up. Mm. Right? That is the hope. But I really wanted to focus on tonight this OPEB trust, because we had a lot of questions at the last meeting, and then we had some other questions that came in. So I really wanted to go over some of this with you guys, so that way maybe there's a little clearer picture of what's going on here. So a few of the highlighted questions. Question one, what are the total OPEB investments that the Treasurer will be investing for both the town and the RMLD? So we have a... Sorry, Tracy, I'm sorry, I'm going to bounce you around. If you could go to two more, one more. Yep. So we have a slide here that shows the total. Since inception of OPEB, the RMLD was the first one to invest in FY11, and then the town started investing in FY12. So the town and all their departments is completely separate than the RMLD itself. So if you look at the investments, if you go to through September of 2019, the RMLD has a total investment of $3.6 million, and the town is investing $5.2 million. Okay? And then if we go to the next slide, Tracy, the OPEB contributions, same thing. RMLD started in FY11. So as far as the contributions go, you can see the varying amounts per year. This is strategically planned most of the time, but it's based on the actuarial reports that we receive and how much, you know, we want to be fully funded at some point. That is the goal here, and how much... where it's as an other investment that we're being asked of that actuarial to meet those demands of becoming fully funded. Okay, so like I already mentioned the totals.
What happened before 2011?
There was nothing. No, just started in 2000 and FY11. That's when we started this OPEB trust. Okay. So I would assume, I wasn't here, but what I'm assuming is the RMLD and the town simply met the obligation of what the OPEB was asking of. Okay. Yes.
On your contributions, the OPEB and FY15, nothing from the RMLD?
FY15, that is correct. Nothing from the RMLD. Again, I wasn't here. I don't know the reason behind it. Sorry. And FY19, just so you know, it's a little bit, the color is a little off because we didn't meet the ending FY19, 6/30/19, because we changed to a calendar year. So we did actually make that contribution in September, just so you know. It just didn't fall in the fiscal 6/30. So the second question, are there any benefits to combining all the investments, such as reduced fees? Now, Sharon Engstrom was very helpful. I asked a lot of these questions, her and Endry, she and Endry, excuse me, they are the ones who handle these funds. So Sharon said that she didn't see any particular benefit in combining the OPEB trust funds for the town and the RMLD, as we would still pay the same 54 basis points at PRIM, which is the equivalent of 0.54%. And PRIM is the Pension Reserves Investment Management Board. So what PRIM says is basically we're not going to charge you a fee, but we're basically just going to give you a direct cost of whatever it cost us. So it's at the equivalent of 0.54%. So if you look at the RMLD's total of $3.6 million, that comes out to about $19,500.
So what, if I may, just a question on that. Do you have to focus on PRIM? Why is PRIM the only investment mechanism?
Well, so based on this idea of reaccepting reaccepting 32B section 20, the whole premise of doing that is so that we can invest in PRIT and the State Retirement Benefit Trust Fund. So the idea behind that is to gain more value on our dollar. So we're looking to target 7.5% as a return. That's what the actuarial actually predicts. And if you look at, I'm going to swing you to another slide here. If you look at the last number slide, going, this is what we currently invest in. So I wanted to show you the picture of what we invest in. We invest in CDs and money markets, and we do have a cash portfolio at the Mass Municipal Depository Trust. We're basically only at we're gaining only 2.5% on our investment.
As opposed to?
What we could get with PRIT and the SRBT, which is 7.5.
Are they getting 7.5?
Actually, historically, they're up to 9.6.
Over the last 10 years or so?
Yeah, it says it right here.
Coincidentally.
It says it, since 1/31/85. Last slide, one more slide. Yep. The second bullet there, assets are invested along with retirement funds, annualized return of 9.6% since inception of 1/31/85 through December 31st, 2017.
That's pretty impressive. I mean,
it is, right?
Right. There are two elements I was concerned about, certainly. One was, what's the kind of return rate? Two, when you combine our funds with the town's funds, do you get any kind of a break as well? Because you're aware of the and most financial service firms do give you a break when you invest more. And third, if you look at what people are charging for doing active management of accounts, let's take Vanguard, for example, it's 30 basis points, not 54.
Right.
So over the long run, that does begin to add up. But this would suggest that the return is certainly worth it.
Worth, right, exactly. And the reason that Sharon and Town Council is basically saying it's not worth combining it because you're gonna pay 0.54 and the town's going to pay 0.54, so it doesn't matter. It's not going to. And if you look at the investments that we currently have, we don't know what the fee structure is because they net it against our return. So that was a specific question I asked as well.
Yeah.
And we don't know.
So.
Because they don't identify the actual fees.
So if you're investing at 10%, let's say you're realizing 10%, if you realize 5% for 10 years, you'll basically double your money. So has the town doubled their money in that period of time that they've invested?
The town, I believe, is investing in the same thing we are right now. They have not moved to PRIT yet. They're waiting on us. So we're holding them up, to be quite honest.
They haven't.
No. Yep. Because it takes about 90 to 120 days once this whole process goes through. The board has already accepted the motions to re-accept, and then you have to actually draw up the trust fund. So it goes, if you look at that last right there, these are the steps. So you re-accept, then you adopt the OPEB funding plan, and then you have the declaration of the trust, which is approved and signed by the commissioners. Then you have to sign the investment agreement, which the treasurer will handle that piece, and then submit to council, submit to the SRBT so that they can present it to their board, and then you transfer the balances. So overall, it takes 90 to 120 days.
Well, the numbers are correct, and that seems like a very good thing to do.
Yes.
Do you happen to know who is actually investing the money? I mean, obviously,
the treasurer.
I'll talk to you later. No, I mean, private equity firms are handling the money.
Oh.
As opposed to like BlackRock and others. I mean, PRIM is not actually doing the investment. They're using third party.
Right.
Okay.
Yes, I was afraid I'm not going to let you speak, Tom. No, go ahead.
it seems, I phrase it this way, but too good to be true.
I know.
So, but
can I invest, Tom?
Is there obviously, there's a lot of equity exposure, so but you tell me there must be some risk. So it's 9% over. So for this kind of account, what does that look like? Because, if the account goes in half next year and then goes back up in 5 years, it could be 9%. But, what happens in those down years? You know what I'm getting at?
I do.
Less than what we're making now, the 2.5.
Oh,
right? So
yes, it can.
So down by a quarter and still be more than what we're making.
Right, yeah.
I mean, and it is a risk, Tom. That's the truth. And there's not,
yeah, what I'm getting at
you can't really answer that question specifically, right?
Yeah, no, but I mean, because, I think think anyone in the country would take 9% heartbeat of whatever they're doing now. And they
yeah, I mean, the Standard & Poor's has been running at probably close to that, you know, 9% over the last, actually, decade. Pretty close.
It's actually been 15% in the last 10 years.
10 years, yeah. So if you invested just in equities, would it have
just happened?
Yeah,
S&P 500.
Yeah, well, I guess what I'm getting at is in our position, what our obligations are, you know, we most people, you know, depending where they are in their time horizon, are willing to live with that risk, knowing they'll, you know, depending what age they are.
How about 125?
I don't know. I think that's the only
125-year time horizon. The risk is stretched out a little bit.
Yeah. I guess what I'm saying, if we had a 2009 scenario, right?
Oh, I understand what you're saying.
What does that mean in terms of our ability to meet our obligations?
2.5% would look really good.
Yeah, it sure would.
Compared to what happened in 2009.
Well, the fact is, we are meeting our obligations. This is outside of that. This is, we're trying to get fully funded with the liability. So I understand your point. If it were to crash, we have the time to build it back up, right? So.
Yeah, but does that put more pressure? Does that affect the formulation? Because the actuaries have a formula at the rate in which we need to
I think that it would have to, at that point it would have to, because they go based on what our actual fund balance is, and you know.
Is that a fact? I guess I'm not involved in finance to know, but would that impact our P&L in any way?
No. Okay. The answer is no there.
I think what Tom's saying is we don't want to be the last fool to get in on the Ponzi scheme. We want somebody else to get in on the Ponzi scheme right after we do.
When, right? Do you have any sense about how much investment Prim has in total?
I'm sorry, I didn't know.
Yeah, Prim obviously solicits input from a number of different places. Do you have any idea what their fund size is?
I do not. I mean, I can look into it. I can do the best I can to try to figure that out, but.
I'd just be curious. I assume it's probably in the multi-hundred million, if not sub-billion or so, if they're really doing this across the country, or are they just Massachusetts-based?
You know what? Okay.
You don't have to answer the question now.
Yeah, let me see if I can do more digging and see what I can come up with.
Seems like a very good
Yeah, my joke aside, actually 2.7% is not bad these days. You know, the interest rates are so low that that's actually not a terrible rate of return.
But we're not meeting what the actuarial predicted.
Understood. I'm just saying it's probably zero risk, and it's actually not
a... Should we make another comment about how actuarials never seem to have the right number? And seriously, that's what happens to your pension, right, in terms of your contributions to it. And it's never what they predict.
And it is the goal of the RMLD to become fully funded. So, I mean...
Okay.
Good.
Thank you.
Good job.
Yeah,
thank you.
Yeah, did a good job. We're going to
put
questions together.
Hamid.
Okay, I'm going to give you my regular reports first, and then we're going to go on the bids, and then after that I'm going to give you a report on last night's storm, the statistics and some of the data. All right?
Yep.
So the first page, major constructions. This is right now we are in the middle of constructing or actually replacing the getaway cables at 4W16 as part of the thermal relief program for that substation to improve the ratings. Marion Street extension, that's going to be completed by end of the year. It's going on right now. We got two phases. Phase one is going to be completed in 2019, phase two in 2020. Basically, Marion Street, it's like a loop that one end is on Burlington Ave and the other end is connected to Chestnut Street. So we are doing the Burlington Ave end first. And then in 2020, we're going to do the Chestnut Hill end to complete the loop. So you're going to see that as part of the budget presentations next month. To see that, you know how that's budgeted. Phase one is going to be completed by end of the year this year. The next one, you see the pictures of basically Marion Street extension, the construction, some of the poles. You see these big pine trees, and you know, these are the ones, unfortunately, that during the storms that threat to our lines. And the project is going very well. We are pretty much at the final phase of phase one. So the construction is going really well as expected, on time, on budget. The next one is the grid modernization. The grid modernization, basically we met the goals. We have met the goals for 2019. The last switch on the scale base switches is on Minot Street. We're waiting for Verizon to set the pole. So that's the only one that's left. On the interrupters, we're right on schedule. The picture on the left, you see that, you know, how complicated it is really to put these switches up. This is on Ash Street, right over here, near the new building, new two-family of a neighbor, the two-family residence that, you know, it's being constructed. So we're still going to have to add radio to those, and then we're going to program them so they can, you know, talk to one another and do the isolation. The area upgrade, this is just the overhead, old overhead area that, you know, we are redoing, upgrading, basically replacing primaries, the secondaries, all the connections, the transformers. We go through these neighborhoods from A to Z, just clean them all out. And that was Deborah Drive in Reading. That it included 14 poles and about 1,100 feet of the primary cables and also 800 feet of secondary cables that they were upgraded. So we got a list of these. We have a pretty good program, and we've prioritized them by age. So nothing to say that, you know, as we plan, something else could jump right and could become priority all of a sudden. So, but we got a program that we go based on that set priorities. The next one shows the pictures of those areas, Deborah Drive. You see these double poles, and also you got to see that, you know, these double poles, the number they're jumping in Reading and Linfield. The reason is because these constructions are usually, you know, lengthy. It's not like that, you know, like you're done in a couple of weeks and then done. These constructions could take up to 6 months sometimes. And until we are done transferring everything and building everything, we're not going to be able to complete the transfers because it's a tedious process when it gets to secondary transfers and connections. So the next one is the step-down upgrade areas. These are basically our favorite projects because for two reasons, because we're killing three birds with one stone. We are actually upgrading the area. We are upgrading poles. We are upgrading the primaries. We are upgrading the secondaries. We are upgrading the connections, everything again, A to Z. And we're getting rid of these step-downs, old step-downs, that there are the causes of losses. I-square R losses or heat, that, you know, that's what that we're paying for. So that would be all in all, it's a good optimization process in order to reduce the losses. The area that we're working on now, it's a Jerry Road and Dury Road in Linfield. There are 40 poles that are, you know, there. And I guess we're at the last phase of that conversion. Meaning cutting over the secondaries and the services. So we should be done in a couple of weeks, in 2 weeks on this, and then we're going to move on to the next one, which is Walnut Street and Atherton Road, which that's going to be another 40 or 50 poles that we're going to go through the same process. The picture is showing the Jerry Road and Dura Road step-down upgrades, and I'm sure in that neighborhood, the people, they see that, you know, trucks, they're all over pulling cables, reconnecting the services to the houses and also upgrading the services. So these are showing some of the double poles and, you know, the poles on those streets. The trees pretty much are cut, so they're cleared from the lines, they're trimmed, not cut all the way, but they're trimmed so just we can pass the wires. And this is what we need to do. If the people they're seeing in the neighborhood that, you know, well, we are trimming the trees and we're making like U-shape cut. This is because those wires, they're going to have to go through and we don't want them to touch. Otherwise, you know, they're going to catch in fire and the pole is going to cessation of service. The next slide showing the maintenance programs, I'm not going to go over them all because you know by now those are the reasons that our reliability are so great. The maintenance program is going well, very well. We are on target, on time, and we're making headways. So I'm proud to say that this is part of the reason that we got such a best reliability in the Northeast region, if not entire Massachusetts. The maintenance program, and the last one, this is the H transformer replacement. We're doing so well on those. We got basically 4,000 transformers, and out of the 4,000 transformers, about 1,500 of them, they're over 25 years old. We got some categories that we determine why this transformer that needs to be replaced. It's not only the age, the load that the transformer has experienced, which, you know, any overloading condition could cut down, deteriorate the windings of the transformer, and it could cause to actually accelerate the cause of the failure. There are those, and plus the physical conditions. So based on those, we have prioritized all the transformers, and we got approximately 37% that they are older than 25 in the system. And we got a pretty good program that, you know, we have prioritized those, and we are going through the neighborhoods, and every year we replace approximately anywhere between 120 to 150 transformers, both in overhead and in underground categories, which, again, they contribute, they're good contributor to the reliability. Do you have any questions?
No, I'm sorry.
Did you have a question?
I'm sorry, yeah.
So the next one is my favorite slide. As I explained, that, you know, you see in Linfield and Reading, we got like in Linfield, we got 84 poles. Those are the step down areas that we are in the middle of the conversion. And as soon as we're done, then they're going to be pulled out. And the Reading, also, we got 34 poles. And these poles are basically as a result of the Deborah Drive construction and also some fiber installation for Light Tower or Crown Castle, the new name. So we are helping them with the attachments and, you know, installing the fiber cable to so they can serve their customers. In North Reading, pretty much we have only one transfer, and also Wilmington, we got like about 10 transfers that we got to do. So we are keeping up with those, pretty much. The next slide is showing the reliability indices. The pictures speak for themselves. We are good across all the categories. We're well below the regional and national averages. So we are heading in the right directions, and everything is good. So I'm not going to go over those. The last slide showing the cause of the outages to date as of September 2019. And again, you see that, you know, this is again the result of the maintenance programs that we have implemented and we are doing. You see across all the categories, with the exception of the ones that, you know, we don't have any control over, like a motor vehicle accidents, you know, and so some of the weather, act of God, you know, which we had last night, and another one. It's unfortunate. They're working against our, you know, numbers, but, you know, but we're still doing good, considering the fact that, you know, we've been hit by some harsh weather this year. Anyway, so this is my report, and if you want to know for the September outages in the month of September, we had 16 outages. They were all over, mostly in Wilmington and Reading area. We've had like about four or five animal contacts. We had some equipment failure and some motor vehicle accidents, three of them. And we had about two trees that were huge trees that they came down and caused an outage to the customers. So basically, that's the list of the outages for the September, which is approximately the same number that we have almost every month. This is my report.
Good.
Any questions?
Looks good. Good tracking.
Appreciate it. So, if you want to go, we can go to the bids now.
Yeah. Do you want to just give us before we go? I know just like what
what these are about, these, the deck and the
just,
roof.
Just one quick item. John's question on how much Prim has invested as of June 30, looking, doing unscientific research on my iPhone.
Yes.
They have $74.8 billion.
That's
the
amount. Okay, good.
Yes.
Give you a sense of stability anyway, right?
And unscientific research.
Would it be out of line just to get a kind of a short explanation of the two bids, one on the patio and deck and the other on the roof, before we get
sure.
into the motion language, or do we have to do the motion language
first? You can do the motion language and then I explain.
Yeah.
Is that what it has,
that
has to go?
That's how you should.
Okay.
Yeah.
You ready?
If you don't mind.
Sure.
Move that IFB 2019-21 for deck and patio renovations be awarded to Neyland Construction Company for $171,000 pursuant to Mass General Laws Chapter 149/C, that's your Chapter 30,
Chapter
Section 39A, as the lowest responsible and eligible bidder on the recommendation of General Manager.
Second.
Yeah.
Okay, we did the OSHA study, and OSHA is a part of the study that deck was, you know, abandoned. It was basically said it's not really in good condition.
You're talking about the deck behind this
building.
Deck
behind the building,
the wooden
right
deck.
Behind the cafeteria.
Yeah.
And as a result of that, you know, we had like about $90,000 for the OSHA remediation plan in the budget. But it came out approximately, you know, the whole construction, $171,000.
But what is that going to be buying exactly?
That's going to be, actually, you got to remove, demolish the existing one, and then we're going to build it, and this one is going to be concrete with the, you know, the handicap ramp and, you know, the...
Do we have a design? We can just kind of curious.
The deck was deemed condemned.
Correct.
So there's no, you can't go out on the deck. And because it was made from plastic, wood, and a concrete handicap ramp that no longer met, it doesn't meet the slope or the width of handicap. We did an analysis to show that we have other handicap exits. So in order to take everything off the building and throw it away for disposal, we're just putting, so when you walk out, there's three doors. When you walk out the door, it's just going to be a concrete pad so that you can have an egress, a set of stairs, and then down the bottom, it's just going to be a flat patio. We're not rebuilding a deck or anything.
So you're just removing, demolishing what's there.
Correct.
And making a concrete pad.
Correct. That's right, with stairs that go down. And there's, I think there's four Jersey barriers that you can put a couple of little plants in that will keep any truck dust and everything coming by, because we don't own the right of way. It's privately owned. So, you know, all the trucks that come in and out, there'll just be some, we'll just stick some arborvitaes in it or something.
So the only thing I'm thinking is, I mean, we were having more discussions at the town level about reuse of this site and the buildings, and you know, I know we don't know whatever's going to happen in the future, but it's just one of these things where.
Well, the last update is that the building is not being torn down or knocked down, and we're still being very prudent about what we're doing.
Right.
We can't continue to operate with a condemned deck or no.
No, I know you can't do that.
So, and we don't want to replicate a deck that has to be maintained.
I don't understand why demolishing is 171.
The concrete and steel, you're pouring some concrete and metal steel. I mean, interestingly enough, the $171,000 was the lowest.
Okay.
The highest came in at, most of them came in at over $275,000.
Right.
So concrete and steel is expensive, and we're not rebuilding the deck. But we need to keep the building in a condition that's suitable for, you know, 80 people to work in without trying to build things that are above and beyond or, you know, it's just a basic, it's about 4 feet. When you open the door, it's just 4 feet of concrete. You go to the right, you go down the stairs, and it's just a concrete pad, and that's it.
Yeah, it does seem, I mean, I guess, obviously, based on the competitive bids, it must be a lot more work.
Right.
It seems like a big
deal. Well, there's a tariff on steel, too. So.
Do you know why the bids were so different here? Why
we,
the other
we just investigated that, and we asked the lowest bidder. You showed this is the number. He says he's got done that 10 times, and this is exactly what it is. Actually, the architect of the designer called them and asked and you sure this is, I said, yeah, the other two guys are high.
Okay.
He doesn't know why the other two guys, they came up high.
I figured maybe John was getting his jacuzzi or something back out there.
But this is also one of the fire exits. Remember that, you know, we needed to fix
it. Yeah, no, it makes more sense to me now that I hear what the scope is. I guess, as we think about what's happening to the site, you know, when we have these six-figure renovations at the site that we don't know in 5-10 years, just want to ask the questions. But yeah, based on what you're saying.
Well, the building is millions and millions of dollars, compared to the worth of the building. And again, it's not a, it's a very bare bones. It's just the price of concrete and steel is really high. It's hard to explain, but I mean, George, do you have any input on this? I mean, you're in DPW. Is concrete and steel tough?
Yeah, well, I mean, you went out for the, and you got the lowest responsible bidder that's out there. And obviously, right now, I mean, construction's at a premium.
Right.
So, I mean, that's what you're paying for. You know, I haven't seen the application, what it's going to be, but I know from what we've been bidding on, a lot of the prices have been coming back higher.
Yeah.
So,
because everybody's got too much to do.
Yeah, there's plenty going on.
Right, so they'll throw out high numbers, and if they get it, they get it, and if they don't, they don't care.
Because they're already busy. Right.
Yeah. But in this case,
I'm familiar with Neyland, so they've done some work with us in the town of Wilmington. So.
Okay.
Yeah. All right, but based on you saying that some of the bids were 100,000 more?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's the key. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Actually, I have the numbers over here from the other two. We got Eagle Corporation for $275,690, and St. John's Corp for $277,576.
Yeah.
So $171,000 in Evan Construction was the lowest.
Let's vote.
And I wanted to the lowest.
Phil believes that we should vote, and I have to say I agree with him. So we have a second motion and a second. Are we ready for the vote?
Let's go.
Okay, all in favor? Okay. That's 5, and all opposed is 5-0. Okay. I will have the same question about the next one, unfortunately.
Move that IFB 2019-22 for remedial coating system for application over an existing age EPDM roof membrane be awarded to Eagle Rivet Roof Services Corp for $272,845 pursuant to Mass General Laws, Chapter 149, Chapter 30, Section 39M as the lowest responsible and eligible bidder on the recommendation, gentlemen.
Okay, as you can see.
That was the motion, right? Tom seconded it. Okay.
As you've been going around the building, you see lots of these barrels that, you know, for the past 3-4 years we've been, you know, collecting rain because the roof's been leaking. You know, the roof is old.
This roof
Either you're going to have to replace that, which is going to cost, you know, over $500,000, or the next option was really to find some type of material that, you know, sealer that you basically laid under the roof and fix that with some, hopefully, you know, that's going to last you, several years. This material that you found, you know, it's going to be 20 years warranted for labor and the material.
This is silicone.
The material itself is 50 years warranty.
Yeah.
But the whole job, you know, with the labor, it's 20 years warranty. And the Eagle Construction was the lowest bidder for $272,845. The others came out, we got two more, $280,000 and $300,000.
I mean, when they put on this material, do they try to put it on an angle so that the water will run off as opposed to...
Yeah, they do that. Actually, the material itself, the company that makes that, you know, that material, which is like a gel type, the sealer, they wanted to have certain contractors, somebody who's certified by them to be installed. So this is the second time we've gone out to bid, but the first time around, the guy wasn't certified. Didn't have certification from the factories, otherwise the warranty would be void. But this time, these three, they have certifications for working with this type of material.
What is the material? Silicone?
I don't know exactly what it is, to be honest with you. Some kind of coating is that, you know, let me see if I can find out for you and send you exactly what the material is.
I know Dave's, question is, again, as per the first Yeah. Here is sure we'd be doing this when we don't know what the future is going to be. But I'd like to just say, I think it was 8 years ago when I first was here and we were fixing the HVAC system. And we had that same question. Well, the town might be doing something different in this building, so we really shouldn't be doing that.
Who said that?
Later. We still don't know what's going to be in the future. Well, so I don't think you can trust anybody.
Well, I know, but still, I'm just asking the questions.
Yeah, of course.
6 years ago, I said I was going to be very careful about what we fixed. And I said, we're going to have to fix the deck. We're going to have to fix the parking lot. And we're going to put in an HVAC unit. And hopefully I can use a crane to take out and reinsert it in another building if we moved. So we've been very, very careful. A brand new rubber roof would cost more than $500,000. So this type of coating, we've spent a lot of time to try to figure out how we could get it to last in the event that it would be knocked down. But I think this building's not going to be knocked down. That's the latest.
No, I wouldn't expect that it would be
demolished. It would stay intact.
Yeah, please, George.
How old is the existing roof, the EPDM roof?
I think Paul said like 30 years or something.
The problem,
they shrink.
You do have saturation of your insulation.
Yeah.
Building codes, of course, have changed over time. Currently, I believe it's 3-inch now that they're using. And what happens, of course, you have, as things compact, that is not going to improve. And even though you pour this material over it, you're still going to have those areas of saturation. You don't know what's under your deck. You know, it's kind of like putting bathtub fitter over what you have.
Yeah, right.
There's anything wrong with that.
No, I know what you're saying.
Yeah, so you're spending over $250,000 to put this down. And you're not getting the R factor, you're not getting any of the improvement, but...
Well, that's what you're saying makes a lot of sense to me, and I wonder, have we done the life cycle analysis? And I'm sorry to do this, but I mean, of getting the R value, as George points out, you'd have energy savings over a long period of time, and that would help defray. And do we have cost estimates on the full replacement?
We can, if you want a presentation, we have been analyzing this roof for years because of the amount of water that's been pouring in and trying not to spend millions of dollars to fix it. And Paul McGonigal, the facilities manager, I believe did his due diligence. We've had a number of vendors come in between new roofs, certain different types of techniques for repair, and this was by far the best warranty that we could get to preserve it.
And we have estimates for $500,000 to replace the whole thing?
It was more than $500,000.
It is more than well over $500,000.
A brand new rubber roof was well over more than $500,000. We don't want the asset to deteriorate as it we keep it an asset.
Oh. Yeah, I just had two questions. Does the warranty, so George made a good point, but are they warranting that it won't leak? Basically,
they warranty that it won't leak, and if it does, they come and fix them.
As
for 20 years.
Many times is it?
For 20 years.
20 years.
Well, that's not a bad guarantee.
So you are getting basically your money. If you spread it, you're talking about $24,000 a year.
So the other, like I said, two other quotes. So the other question is, because of the duration of time, we're talking about the financial stability of the company. I don't know the company. George, I mean, they go out of business and warranty.
Sometimes you want to do moisture analysis on roofs just to see what type of moisture is in there, if you're trapping that in there.
It's 20 years for $10,000 tax, $14,000 a year it's going to cost. I correct myself. But they did the laser, analysis on the roof to see where are the weak spots. And what they do, they go heavier on those weak spots, from what I understand. But is it the total solution? Obviously not. This is the cheapest solution. We go, 20 years, for 20 years, if you can get out of that. By then, we know what the fate of the building is, even if town decides to go in a different direction.
I might just suggest maybe getting a reference. Obviously, they've done it for other companies, just to make sure that
George asked about the moisture analysis. Has that been done?
I don't know. We are going to have to do that and probably bring it back to the data.
Yes. Okay. We have a, as I was hoping, a member of the public is going to speak. Please come up. Oh, okay. Come on up and sit down and,
thank you.
Give your name and address. And
Scott James, and I'm with Eagle River Group Service.
Yep.
Business address is 2 Boxcar Lane.
So you're the vendor?
I'm the contractor.
You're the contractor?
Yep.
Okay. So you put the bid together?
Correct.
Okay. All right, go ahead.
To Mr. Hooper's point, there was an infrared analysis done. There is provisions in the bid to change out wet insulation down to the deck and address that. The scope of it won't be necessarily perfect as an infrared. There may be more, there could be less when we open it up.
Is it metal decking?
Yes, correct. Metal B decking. And we'll replace it with an in-kind isocyanurate insulation.
What's the material? What type of material is that?
The coating process, the GECO, is a silicone.
Silicone.
Another particular question.
I'm just looking for references in terms of other places that have used this process and material.
It's becoming more and more popular to use a coating system like this because of the cost analysis of having a lot of buildings. You know, with building code, you can have 2 complete roof systems on there now. You know, with this, it's actually not coated as a roof system. So a lot of buildings that are reaching their useful age for the second roof as well, this coating system is being applied. So the technology has come tremendously far. We're doing it in an awful lot of public buildings, a lot of public school systems as well.
Around this area?
Yes.
Yep. So it would be very easy to get a recommendation from someone who's put it on.
Most definitely.
Tried it for a couple of years. Or
correct, yeah. And that was furnace in our bid pack, which I'm sure could be turned over to you at any point.
Scott, when Amin was talking, I wasn't clear. So there's the product warranty and then there's the installation. But is the warranty just with one? There's not like one of these where the installer or the applicator, you know.
No, the process of being.
Who warranties it? Is your company warranty?
We would be the vendor on the warranty, yeah.
Yeah, including if it's an installation problem or a product.
Correct, yeah. Typically, there's going to be a technical rep out here several times during each of the processes, and they monitor it to make sure.
I only know because I've been involved in coatings in a different way, and, you know, there's the installer, and then there's, you know, the company that manufactures it, and, you know, its application, of course, is a critical.
Correct, preparation and application.
You're not the same company that bid it on the other thing, are you?
No, not at all. I heard the word Eagle.
Yeah, I was going to say Eagle put in a high bid. Okay, fine. No. Different company. 2 Eagles.
Double Eagle.
1 meeting. Double Eagle. any other questions that anybody has? It's a good discussion, you know, and with a big expense like this, it's good to talk it through.
It's nice to have someone
what John said about the, you know, being over time, I think 6 years ago, talk about this building. We built this building. The idea was this building would be here for 50 years.
Okay.
We're long short of 50 years.
Yeah, the roof system up there is roughly 28 to 30 years old. That's some of the manufacturing.
Off some of the EPBM when you do this?
Or
do you
Yeah. There will be some. Yeah. There will be patched there. Yeah.
So there's no way to put down an additional insulation on the top and then encode it, I guess.
No, we'd have to take everything off.
Yeah.
Yeah, because there's a taper system and everything along that line. Because you were talking about as far as shedding water.
Yes, shedding water.
Yeah, there's a taper system up there now. We'll obviously work with it and keeping that going to the drains and whatnot. So anything that we do replace, we're going to try to
keep our barrels, right? We've got barrels around.
we'll go for the drains rather than the barrels. Yeah. Yeah, that's not our luck. No, we don't particularly care for that. Anything else I can answer for you, folks?
No, thank
anybody
you.
Anybody else?
No, I feel much more comfortable. Right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah,
thank you very much.
I think we're ready for a vote. Okay. We have a motion and second.
Second.
Right. All, we already had
that. There's a second. Second.
I think Tom was the second. And all in favor of approving the bid. Okay. We have 5 in favor. And how many are against? That's none. Okay, so the motion passes, and we're getting a new roof. Thank you, Wendy, for whatever you're smiling at.
Water must be coming down in your area.
Wendy and I are excited that we can get rid of the extra buckets in the
middle
of
our
house.
I'll just say the wet marks on the presentation.
Okay, so now we are going to... oh, right, of course he does. Please.
I figured, Joe, well, we got to give you an update on this storm. But the storm started last night around midnight,
maybe
11 p.m. So we started off with like about 1,500 customers that were affected all over, mostly in Linfield and Reading, and some in Wilmington and some in North Reading. So right now we are down less than 50.
Where'd you start with the meeting?
Well, okay, what is that?
What was the starting number?
Starting was about 1,500 customers. Wow. Yeah. And then at some point, went up and down, and, the storm was...
Does that get done with just the crews? Do you have to get outside of town?
Yes, what we did, we had five RMLD crews, two-man crews, and three power line. We have them all around anyway for the construction. So two crews had to stay down, and we asked for an extra crew, another crew. So we had a total of 8 crew that they were helping us through the restorations, the engineers, myself, John, and assistant general mine foreman. So and technical services people, pretty much everybody was involved. But obviously, like during the storm, we put set priorities. Priorities are with where the wires are down, the public way, try to make them safe, and then we move on to the lateral taps and also the services that they coming down the wires that they're down on the driveways and stuff like that. So we cut them and then we put it back up after we made everything safe and so on. We had a number of poles that we snapped on top. We had 2 areas that the transformers basically they came down on the Linfield. Main Street that the transformers they came down and unfortunately we had oil leak that they went down the catch basins and now they're reportable to DEP.
Yeah.
We are going to do that in a timely manner. But all in all, we made it safe to the public and we still got the operations goal. So I'm just going to go over quickly over these to see that the outages, what happened. We had blown cutouts, we had limbs on the primaries, blown fuses. We had in the areas like Parsons Lane and individual outages and down services, trees, and it was all over. It was a mess. It was a mess when we started in Reading. This is in the Reading area.
The one on 129 was pretty big, at least when I drove by.
Yeah, I'm getting you into that.
Oh, okay.
It's coming up. So this one, the next one, this shows some of the activities in Selim Street. Selim Street, this was the one that, we had the broken pole and obviously the transformer on it. And then the crews got there and, they set the pole and they put everything back up again to fix them. This was the worst one in Main Street. You could see the broken pole right over here.
I saw that.
So this was really bad. The next one in Reading was the Parkman Road. Parkman Road got really hit bad. As you could see, the transformer is on the ground. Okay, the area, no danger in that because the fuse already popped up. But the transformer, you could see that the top of the tank split open and the oil obviously is released. And now we do the cleanup. So
that's not PCBs, is it?
What is it?
Not PCBs, is it?
No, we don't have any PCBs. But the three huge tree, as you see on the top, brought all the wires and everything. This is the kind of damage that the people might not see that, but this is what we're dealing with, and that's what taking some time really to set the new pole and bring the new transformer and restore the power to the.
Was it
takes several hours? Sometimes. For some other
Hamid, when can you actually, is there some things you can't do while the storm is still in full? I was thinking about this as it was blowing last night, about your crews going out. When can you do certain things and when can you not do certain things? Do you have to wait for the storm to subside to do some of them?
If it's reasonable, you know, about 40, 50, 60, 50 miles per hour, you know, still if we need to get out, we get out. But if it's about 100, 110, you know, it's dangerous because once you put the boom up, now you're talking about the, you know.
But you'll put the boom up in 48 mile an hour winds?
But we've done that, you know.
So there were times last night you couldn't go out.
Yes.
Yeah.
Same as, you know, during these storm, winter storms, you know, that's, you know, when the wind and gusts there, you know, it's hard.
Mm.
They have to have the protective gloves on, and it's really hard, you know, to work on those, especially hot summer days and, you know, very cold days. Mm. You know, it's really a tough job. I mean,
yeah.
This is not the job that anybody can do.
Right.
Lots of credit to our linemen and, you know, technical services for being out there, and the 110 degrees, you know, or, you know.
Your branches are still falling.
Oh, yeah.
While you're working out there.
That's right. You know, and it's really bucket truck being 50 feet up in the air and wind blowing, you know, up in there.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to ever experience that again. So, I wouldn't recommend it. But our guys, you know, they got harness and everything, you know. It's not fun being there.
No.
And, you know, 10 feet above the ground, and you see the bucket is moving left and right, you know, wondering where it's going to tip over, you know.
Yeah.
So, you don't want to be doing that. So, that's apartment road that, you know, that was the one that it took the longest because they had heavy damages. We had 4 or 5 poles down. And usually when these heavy pine trees, they come down, they bring 4 or 5 poles in either directions out, and, you know, some of them we have to wait for Verizon, obviously, you know, in the Verizon set area, like after ready in Linfield and Wilmington.
Yeah.
So it takes a long time. So if the ones in our service territory, we are right there, right away, we set the poles, and those are the ones that, you know, the people, they're going to be brought back on, you know, almost in no time. But the ones that we have to wait for Verizon, you know, we have to wait for them to come in, and then, you know. So this is the 26 Parkman Road, so you see the kind of damage.
What tree, by the way, was that a tree on private property that came down, or was that a street tree?
That was, you know, it's hard to say which one is really private property or it's town street, because the boundaries are not really so clear. You know, we have to come back and do the analysis to see whether it's town or not. So it's hard to tell, but, you know, when the trees, they come down, whether it's across the street, in the neighbors, or the private property tree, or whatever, when they come down, then now it becomes our problem.
Right. When it lands on the wires, you got
to
take.
Yeah, we get the wires, we're going to have to get it back up. On the, the next area is North Reading. The outage is basically, we're in Haverhill Street, Scotland Heights, and Mentis Farm, and, you know, we had the power restored there by 11:45 a.m. Plymouth area, Timber Lane, you know, tree down, individual outages, down services, many down services. These are now private trees that they bring their own service down. And now, you know, usually what we do, we go around, we cut them, and then, you know, we pull them back up. If it's something that could be fixed immediately, we do that. I just want to remind the residents that, you know, if the service has been knocked out of the house and it ripped, you know, we can't just reconnect it. It has to be fixed by the electrical contractor, the electricians. So they should call. If you see that, you know, we call you and we ask you to call an electrician, you know, because it's owner's responsibility to
with the connection to the house.
Connection to the house. And then once we feel that, you know, it's safe or wide respect, you know, the connections, then we, you know, put it back up and get them. So don't be mad at us that, you know, why we're not putting the service, because there's only so much we could do. And we go by the safety code to make sure we're not jeopardizing your family's safety as well as the public safety by reconnecting. next slide shows the Concord Street in North Reading. You see that, you know, how the tree, this pine tree that snapped and pulled the wires down. Now, in this situation, you see it's the wires are landing on the connects. And these are the stuff that, you know, we really are, we've got to be careful because it could be that connects could get energized.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
the what could get energized?
The connects, the trailer, is a trailer or connects, something that, you know, right, the wires are right on top of that.
Called a connex box. It's like a trailer, like a Massport trailer.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So these are the ones that, you know, it's they're very dangerous, or sometimes they come down on the cars, and we really strongly recommend, if the wires are coming down the car, as a safety point to the public, don't touch any metal part of the car. The thing to do is use your cell phone and call 911 and let them come in and assist, okay, because those lines could be energized.
Yeah.
And then, you know, the procedures for that, when you open the door, you know, you have to be careful, because if the wires is still down, even up to 25 feet away from the car, it still could be energized. So what you should do, you should jump.
We advise not to get out of the car.
No, they don't
at all.
But if they open, even when they open the door, the fire department opens the door, still, you know, you should treat that like as kind of energized.
Yeah.
So,
what did you say about jumping? What?
Yeah, they're jumping with 2 feet because, you know, that's what we have a video that, you know, on the safety that we can show you.
It's a shuffle technique so that you're not grounding, but we don't recommend that. If there's a wire down your car, stay in the car until electric comes and disconnects it and says that it's disconnected. It's too difficult to describe an emergency procedure on shuffling out of a car.
Yeah, it's very dangerous, so you should be careful, yes. But don't assume everything is de-energized, because even though if that line is de-energized and we de-energize that, something else, a neighbor, you know, could be energized and could, you know, backfeed, or those are times that, you know, we should, nothing is 100% de-energized, even if we deem that to be de-energized. So you should be careful. So this is the Concord Street, North Reading. You see that? That was the damage. The next one is the Green Street in North Reading. You see that the tree took down the pole, and that you see that it's pretty clear, and Carlos blocked the road over here. You see that?
Some nice foliage there, too.
It's beautiful.
It's beautiful foliage, too.
It's beautiful.
And this one,
other than the disaster.
Yeah. The transformer, again, we had the oil spill, because it hit, as soon as it hit the ground, you know, we had the oil spill that we are reporting. That's reportable. The next area is the Wilmington area. In Wilmington area, we had, again, lots of sporadic outages. Roosevelt Road, Suncrest Avenue, 16 Dead End Drive, and individual services, secondary wires, primaries, everything down. In the next picture, you see that. That's a 16 Dead End Drive in Wilmington. Again, you see that large tree that snapped, came down, and brought the wires down. But the power line, it was restored at noon. Again, this one damaged a transformer, and they had oil spill on that one too. So these are the stuff that, you know, we have to report to the DP and clean up. The cleanup process could be, you know, timely fashion, but we have to do it in certain time and do the reporting, follow up with the reporting to make sure everything. The last one is the Linfield Center. The outages in Linfield Center were, you know, the Walsh Road, Pine Street, Saunders Road, and Highland Ave. And again, we got lots of damages in Linfield area. The picture, you see that number 5 Lander Road, and that one was another one that we had transformer down, as you could see over here, brought down. Few poles, and this is the large tree that came down and actually brought everything down. 4 or 5 poles damaged, and I believe that they're back on now, right? No, we're still working on them. Okay, yeah, it took a long time to set those poles, but this is the only area and a couple other customers. They're still out. But basically, that concludes the report.
It's a nice report. Yeah. Good to get the pictures.
You can do a PG&E and just shut off the power and everything.
A rolling blackout. Very good. Yeah, nice work.
Thank you. I want to thank your crews, the line department, the engineers, and technical services, John, and the rest of the people.
Yep. Thank you.
Make sure that you know we
it's dangerous work.
It is.
Would anybody like to see the presentation again?
I just had a quick comment, Mr. Chair.
Yes, Tom.
So, Colleen, I think some summation of this for the towns would be useful. Now, I mean, for the residents that our customers, because I mean, people have experienced it. No, George, I know you know the responsiveness of the RMLD, but I think it's when you start with 2,400 outages and you get down to 50 in the same day, and that's remarkable. I think people are conditioned on the news to hear of people being out of power for days, but so it's a great message. I just think it's probably an opportunity for us to communicate that.
Maybe we should videotape this presentation and send it out to the town.
So.
Only CQG?
We have put this on the website.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, thank you, Amit, very much.
Can I say something?
Yeah.
As soon as our OMS and IVR is all together, they'll be able to see it on the map. And they'll be able to go to our website and see where the outages are, how many people are out. They'll get all the information. It's coming.
How soon?
Okay.
Yeah, but then
I'm going to tell you what we are doing. We're making really great progress because we are trying to integrate the OMS with the IVR. And the IVR right now, they're going through the testing because there's some challenges. We've got, calling 29,000 customers. That's a worst case scenario. So we're kind of had some challenges there. So I believe by end of the year, everything is going to be tested and ready to go.
I think that's great. What I'm really talking about is a proactive communication out, whether it's on Twitter or Facebook or some combination or other, not as technical means, because it will be on site, but there's a lot of stuff on the website. People don't go to the website a lot.
Well, the IVR is being tested to be able to go to your phone like National Grid.
Okay, well,
you'll have all the information. You can see the polygon of the area that's out. It'll give you updates.
Yeah.
We're harnessing the semi-smart meters that we
have. I just think it's a great message that everyone should hear.
But pretty soon we're going to start the campaign of giving people options. You go there, register through the website, and then you can pick the options of phone, text, or email, or all three of them. And then once you register, then as soon as there's an outage, there's a message coming to you that you experienced an outage with an estimated restoration time. And then when we restore the power to your house, you're going to get a call back that your power should be back on. And if you're still out, you need to contact your electrician or check the breaker or something to make sure that the breakers are working fine or there's nothing else going on in the house. But it's going well. As a matter of fact, today, with the outage information, the outage management system, as soon as we had those areas, we could see the polygon of showing the outage, the magnitude of the outage.
Thank you very much, Hamid, for that excellent presentation.
Good job.
Mm-hmm. And for all the work everybody's doing. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So, thank you. I think we're good on Thursday the 21st for our next one. Is that okay with everybody?
Yep.
And then, as Colleen mentioned earlier, we're going to look to do a special meeting on December 5th to discuss town payment. And
Do we have another meeting too?
Yeah, then we'll have another one on the 19th.
Okay.
And then one on the 25th of December.
I'm going to miss that one.
Yeah.
Yes.
So,
what meetings do we have besides these?
Kidding aside, it's Thursday, November 21 is our next board meeting. Then December 5th, a special meeting to talk about town payment and get that process rolling.
Okay.
And then
I don't have that in our calendar.
It will be.
Yep.
It is not yet on our calendar.
Yep.
As of tonight, we are putting it on our calendar.
And George, the CAB meeting might be on the 21st.
It is the 23rd.
No, that's our
calendar.
October, October, November.
Towards October.
Okay. But the November, can it be, or doesn't look like November, December have been scheduled yet, but I'm just thinking of the November one.
Is the 5th, the December 5th meeting normal start time, 7:30?
Well, we'll figure it out.
Okay.
Probably. We'll assume that it is.
21st is the board meeting, so you think the CAB meeting might be then, too?
Yes, 6:30 will be there.
Oh, okay, good.
We don't take as long. Yeah.
They don't take as long.
Oh. We like to tell more jokes than you guys.
And if someone, there's a CAB meeting this week, right? Or next week?
23rd, next
yep.
week.
And is there a board member there for that?
I think that's you, Tom.
No, I have November.
Okay.
Oh, I get to do back to back.
Who's got October?
I had
last month.
I had September.
Is it my turn?
Oh, right. Yes. Sorry. I forgot about that.
You.
I said it's the most important.
We understand.
Maybe it's my turn. Okay.
We got you, Phil.
We can't. We don't have to post that. Tuesday we could.
What time?
No, Tuesday is. Yeah, it's Tuesday.
Well, it does.
Okay.
I think, again, you got to start with what we need. So we can get the documents that. Colleen's valuation
23rd?
Is going to be.
Oh, it's a different time.
That's
okay, good.
Yes, I'll come back here for our meeting.
When do you think the valuation
is? I see, because your meeting in Wilmington, it's a different day than
when
you be here.
Days.
It's the same
this
day.
Week is fine.
Okay.
Monday and Tuesday, but I'm leaving on Wednesday.
I think Monday and Tuesday is too tight.
Wednesday morning? Could you do Wednesday morning? Is that too early for you?
You can do the following week.
I think it's important, but at this stage you may want to do it. You want to do it thoughtfully because you've got to look at your own
situation. Let's take it off. Unless we have an answer right now, let's take it off.
We should target to do it the week after.
Yeah, the week after next. Yeah, real quick. There goes Karen. Can we get those? Let's quickly just on those minutes. Where are we on minutes? I know it's not on the website, but what's been approved?
Approved by Ashmi?
Yeah, what's been already.
Is one of us holding it up?
No.
Okay. So since we have this work, I'm wondering what would it take to get those? We don't have anything to approve tonight. Right?
Can I just add something?
Please.
We're really excited that we just hired an HR person.
Yeah.
But in all honesty, I've been the GM and HR, and Tracy's been the assistant and the second half of HR, and we have been straight out.
Oh,
and
yes,
and
okay.
The minutes, while they are very important, we've had a lot of, we've posted a lot of jobs. I mean, we're going to be going into executive session.
It's not urgent.
Contracts, which, as Tracy says, they'll be a priority after we get the CBAs signed,
right.
And then that's the next priority.
Are there unapproved? But can I just ask if there are unapproved ones that are in draft form? You have to go draft them.
Ready for the motion to go to session?
Yes, good. We are ready for the motion to go to
move
session.
Move that the board go into executive session to consider the purchase of real estate, to discuss confidential, competitively sensitive, and proprietary information in relation to making, selling, and distributing electric power and energy, and to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining and return to regular session for the sole purpose of adjournment.
Second. All in favor, roll call. Is that what we have?
Ms. Machino, aye.
Aye.
Yes, yeah.
Thanks, everybody.
Bye.
Nice short.